So let me take this opportunity to introduce our speakers. Michael Lynch will speak first. He's a professor of philosophy at the University of Connecticut, where he also directs the Humanities Institute. He's responsible for bringing 7 books into the world. And his next book...
We're guilty.
Culpable. Which is called, his next book, which is called The Knowledge Machine, Knowing More and Understanding Less in the Age of Big Data, will come out next year. Harlo Holmes is an activist web developer who is head of Metadata at the Guardian Project. Software developer, apologies. Ingrid Burrington does a bunch of things. She tells me that she writes, she makes maps, she takes photos, she tells jokes.
I just tell jokes.
She just tells jokes. Okay, she tells jokes. And she's also a fellow at the Data and Society Research Institute and a member of Deep Lab. And Ben Wizner is director of the ACLU Speech, Privacy and Technology Project. He's litigated numerous cases involving 9/11 civil liberties abuses, including challenges to airport security policies, government watch lists, extraordinary rendition, and torture. And he's also a legal advisor to the NSA whistleblower Edward Snowden. And finally, our moderator this evening is Sarah Leonard, senior editor at The Nation and contributing editor at Dissent and the New Inquiry. So to get the ball rolling, I wanted to pose a philosophical challenge that I hope will just sort of hover over whatever else our speakers discuss. So then I won't ask people to respond necessarily directly to it, but just to kind of think obliquely maybe in relationship to this kind of question. So it's widely accepted that privacy is a modern value. In a recent book, Jeremy Rifkin writes that in virtually every society that we know of before the modern era, people bathed together in public, often urinated and defecated in public, ate at communal tables, frequently engaged in sexual intimacy in public, and slept huddled together en masse. It wasn't until the early capitalist era that people began to retreat behind closed doors. And it's that last sentence that I want to focus on. What Rifkin is effectively asking us to ponder is whether our insistence on privacy is not also an insistence on the private, and hence on the bourgeois, and on the capitalist. In The March on Technology, Rifkin sees the potential for a new collaborative commons that would take us beyond privacy to, quote, connect everyone and everything in a neural network marked by the value of transparency. Now, that sounds a little optimistic, to put it mildly, and it's echoed by the chief executives of Google and so on. But there is an underlying challenge that's surely worth our attention, which is, imagine a modern society that just didn't have the concept of privacy as a value at all. What would that society be missing? Is there anything that it would be gaining? Now, imagine a modern society that valued privacy much more than ours. What would it be gaining? And what would it be missing? So I just wanted to lay that question down, and with that on the table, I'll hand over to Michael to...
All right, so I'd like to talk about that question directly. It's a philosophical question, and I'm a philosopher, so there you go. What, if anything, would be lost in a society which had even less privacy than our own? Well, I don't think we actually have to think too hard about what that society would be like. It's happening right now. Oh, we're already in it. We can, if you'd like, though, we can sort of lean on the past to think about it. So we can, we don't have to go too far back. We can go to Jeremy Bentham, philosopher, right? Well, yes, indeed, exactly. I noted. Right, I'm sure Bentham might come up with it. So let me be the first to mention his name. Let's hope it doesn't appear. Say it 3 times. I was thinking Voldemort. Bentham was the designer of the Panopticon, which was a prison that he thought was really cool, which was sort of a prison in the round. And the idea was the prisoners were completely exposed to the, what he often sometimes called the guardians. And they had no privacy at all. And actually, Bentham thought that this was a good model of society. He at one point wrote that it would be better if society was like an open gymnasium, that was the word that he used, in which everyone's behavior was open to everyone else. What Bentham was arguing, what he said explicitly, was that observation affects behavior. Observation affects behavior. And he thought that people would be better behaved if we could all see what we're all doing. We'd be better behaved. Well, and of course, in one sense, if any of you are parents here, you know that observation does affect behavior, right? Observation does affect watching, does affect how behaved we are. But I don't know about you, but and maybe I just don't share the right Torian sensibilities, but I'm not particularly interested in living in a society that's better behaved. I don't think that the better behaved society is necessarily the more just or moral society. I think lots of societies that have had less privacy than our own have also had sort of other problems like slavery, war, rape, murder. Those things happen in those societies as well. So, I think it's a mistake to think that actually that privacy is just, as Rifkin thinks, a modern value. In fact, I think that, I suppose as my notes remind me to tell you, what I'm talking about here is a certain type of privacy. Privacy is a word that comes in a lot of different flavors, comes in a lot of different senses, and I'm interested, I think we all are probably, interested in information privacy, and that's a word that also is difficult to define. But a good gloss, a good working gloss, is that information is private to the extent to which you have some control over it. And that's problematic in ways that I'm sure we'll talk about tonight. But in that sense, information privacy is not a closed door, it's rather the ability to turn the key. So arguably, in my view, speaking a little bit more philosophically, the conceptual source for a concept of information privacy is a fact about the human mind itself. And this gets back to my point, that's not just a modern value. I mean, philosophers like Descartes and Locke thought that part of what made your mind different than other people's minds is that you had a certain private access to it. And they meant by that at least two things. One is that you could, I can walk a mile in your shoes, I can't really sense how that is from the inside, from your perspective. And also, you have some ability to control how to share that subjective experience with others. And they thought that was a sort of defining feature of the mind, and I think they were onto something there. And that's one reason, I think, that we value privacy. There's this connection to the privacy of the mental. Now, if you're thinking about it that way, then a sort of easy way to sort of think about what we would lose if we lost privacy is to think about what it would be like, what you'd lose if I could read your mind. If I could read your mind, like Professor X, and I could just do a mind meld, dating myself here, yeah. Right, with you, whether you liked it or not. I just read your mind, whether you liked it or not. Now, would that be bad? Well, you might say, well, it depends on what I'm going to do with it, right? What am I going to do with it? Am I going to save the world? Or am I going to do something more nefarious? But actually, I think that, if you think about it, it would be sort of creepy all in itself, right? There's something wrong about that. And what would be wrong about that? Well, what I think would be wrong in itself about it is the fact that I'd be undermining your autonomy of decision. I'd be undermining it by foreclosing on a certain, making moot a certain decision that you could make, the decision to share information with me. I've foreclosed on it. I've made that decision for you by reading your mind. And I think that really gets to a main point that I would just want. What do I think we lose? Well, I think we lose some autonomy. Now, that might be, of course, there's times when that's justified. There's always time. I mean, the relationship between the individual and the state is all about negotiating that. But it's important to remember that that's what's at stake. That's what's at stake. Now, very briefly, I think a second reason that I find a loss of privacy troubling is more instrumental. In the law, right, there's this idea of an attractive nuisance. A pool bear with me now. A pool, a swimming pool, a real pool, is an attractive nuisance. You have to put fences around it. Because even if you're a really good parent, even if you're really super watchful, the law says, well, wait a second, you know, you might always be there. Things might happen. The pool of information that the NSA, for example, is collecting about us is like that. It's an attractive nuisance. So even if the designers of the NSA's surveillance program have the best intentions, I worry about the fact that that pool of information is an attractive nuisance. Everyone likes to dive in the pool. Okay. So just, you know, look, privacy matters because autonomy matters. And getting back to Johnny's question, imagine what would we, you know, what would be like if we had less privacy? Well, imagine that now I can just read your mind and you can read mine. In fact, we could all read each other's minds. That would be sort of cool, you know, like, in a way, you know. I mean, it would sort of be, you know, we'd be able to coordinate, you know, really fast. You know, like, you know, we'd be able to, you know, meet up at the bar a lot faster. We'd be able to do all sorts of things faster. It would also, I mean, look, you folks seem really nice people, right? But, you know, I'm not really sure that I want to read everyone's mind. And I'm not sure I would want to be in that hive mind mentality. Why? Because again, think back to the Cartesian and Lockean point. At that point, if we're all reading each other's minds, if we're all reading each other's minds, how different are we? How different are we now part of the hive mind? So I think that's a sort of, that's a way of getting at the point that you raised. So I leave you with that thought and happy thought. And with this final happy thought, which is, you know, when we talk about privacy, we're also talking about knowledge. We live in a time now in which we know more about the world than so much easier than ever before, thanks to the thing that I have in my pocket and the thing that you have in all of your pockets. But the world also knows a lot more about us. Knowledge is power. Power corrupts. Absolute knowledge. Make corrupt,
absolutely. I have a slideshow. I have a lot of disorganized notes in so many paper forms and also digital. But hi, I'm Harlo, and I'm just gonna kind of motion over there. I work for a group called the Guardian Project. We build we build software solutions for bespoke clients like lawyers, NGOs, human rights defenders. Various three-letter organizations, not the ones that you're thinking, the other ones. Like Department of Labor, you know, so like human rights people within our government, what's it called, Voice of America, stuff like that, in order to bring about change around the world. And it's a work that I'm very, very proud of. Also, I just got off of a whirlwind fellowship with the Knight Mozilla Open News Foundation, which takes software developers and who have like interesting questions and puts them in newsrooms around the entire world in order to help newsrooms better figure out what to do in this barrage of data that we're living in. And also, a member of Deep Lab, along with Ingrid here, which is a quote-unquote cyber-feminist collective that solves to answer contemporary questions concerning women in particular, but not only, in code as well as in discourse. My research interest is in metadata and has been for the past like almost decade. Metadata, there's the definition there according to Google. I Googled it for a reason, because Google's the best place to get any answer to any question. However, TLDR, metadata is actually just, or at least in terms of my practice and how I practice it, it's the process of hanging out with data in such a way that you don't even have to look at the data, but the data will just kind of like call to you with like its correct, you know, like with its secrets, and then you'll know without actually having to look at what it's actually saying, just hanging out with it. So my formal, I guess, background, quote unquote, is in actually the metadata concerning images and video. And so my favorite thing in the world, actually one of the reasons why I got into it, is because I heard about like this thing that Microsoft used to have, which is called PhotoSynth. And they no longer have this product because you know, it was a University of Washington project. It got bought by Microsoft. It got parceled out into like various different components that is now in a Windows phone, and who has a Windows phone? But what it did do, which was really awesome, was to use techniques of what's called photogrammetry, which is actually the way that, you know, how you take panoramic photos and like they just like seam together. It's that technology in order to, yeah, put together a photo of anything. A photo of anything based off of like a query. So you would Google, you would Bing.
As we all do. Yes.
Yeah. Notre Dame Cathedral, and what it would do is it would create a 360 panoramic view of Notre Dame Cathedral or whatever you plugged in based off of the various photos on the internet that match your query. So why this is interesting is because it got to the point where their algorithm was so advanced that it kind of spiraled out of control. So for instance, if you typed in Notre Dame on, you know, in Bing, what it would do is it would create this like 360 panorama of Notre Dame, but it would be like included in the photos that it pulled from the internet were people's like posters that were hanging in their dorm rooms, people's, you know, like drawings that they would post to DeviantArt and stuff like that. And so that's really cool because like when you're looking at it, you're getting this like kind of uncanny pastiche of all of these photos that are tied together in purely in metadata in order to bring about this clear picture. And so why I thought that was so awesome was because it reminded me of, you know, like that famous trope when you're watching a movie or like CSI or whatever, when somebody like the hacker is like, you know, so their boss is standing over their shoulder and the boss goes like, zoom in and enhance. And they're like, oh, yes. all of a sudden, like this, you know, like blurry picture because they typed in some magical command would like create extra pixels that would make the image more vibrant. But that doesn't happen in real life because that's not how photographs work. But nowadays, it actually is how things work because instead of finding more pixels to enhance the photo, what we're doing is we're actually searching the networked connections between objects on the web in order to fill in the blanks when we have a question. I had a video of zoom and enhance, but I think we get the idea. It's really funny. It's on YouTube. So in my research, actually, this came out of my master's thesis when I was at NYU. It was during Occupy Wall Street times. I remember the good old days. I created an app that would, you know, take the photograph or the video and attribute extra metadata to it. And the reason why, like, you know, of course you have, like when you take a photo, if you have your settings turned on, it will capture your latitude and longitude in your what's called EXIF data, which is metadata that's hidden in a photograph. Really, really quick detour. My favorite anecdote in all of journalism is that of how John McAfee got busted, where like, you know, he like murdered somebody, and or maybe he didn't, I don't know, probably. But like these journalists from Vice magazine went down to I think Belize, where he was like hiding out And out of hubris, he invited these journalists in, and he was like, yeah, here we are in Belize, or like, no one will ever find me, I'm on the lam. And the photographs that these journalists uploaded to Vice and then uploaded to the world actually were not scrubbed of their metadata. So we had our latitude and longitude of where this guy was hanging out, and that's how he was brought to justice, maybe? I don't know. TLDR. But the point is that you understand that images, now that they're digital, have like this kind of binary. And just like a Polaroid photograph has like that image, and then it's surrounded by this frame, digital images or digital artifacts in themselves have, you know, this human readable side that spreads kind of like a virus, because we like to click on things and we like to interact with one another and we like to share things, but also has this like a backside that's entirely exists for computers, that's really just about counters and quantization of these metrics. And that's the really interesting thing about metadata that's kind of driven me forward. So what we did was we actually made this app that, like, yeah, you know, it has your like latitude and longitude, but it also pulls in extra sensory data such as your visible Wi-Fi networks, visible Bluetooth neighbors, which is an interesting way of establishing groups of people. Also has things like, you know, light meter and compass bearing, so you can actually say that, like, because I'm facing this side, or because I'm facing north rather than south, you know that this photo was taken from inside the prison cage rather than outside. That kind of a thing. And the point is to just attempt to add more accountability to like what we call like the your event, like the original event itself, and the philosophers and everyone talking It's a library. We've been working with like the International Bar Association and the International Criminal Courts and the UN actually to kind of like make this a real thing. But of course, we realize that this is an awesome idea. However, in the wrong hands, it's the power of the ideas kind of like shifted. So it's no longer about, you know, doing right in the world. It's about like exploitation and horrible things that we don't necessarily want to see come about in the world. So to illustrate that, this right here is kind of the first example of a photographic metadata as actual data, or like a photograph as data is what I want to say. And what that is a chronograph of someone blinking their eye. And why that's interesting is because, you take an event that exists in human time, and then you kind of atomize it into its separate parts in order to encapsulate it into a form that a computer can read. And if you'll advance the slide. This actually has a history that's pre-computers. This photograph is one of my favorite things in the world. It's the first, very, very first group of photographs that have to do with metadata. And this is actually from a psychiatrist named Jean Charcot, who was a protege of Sigmund Freud. He pioneered the practice of what's called flash catalepsy. And so what that means is like, okay, so a woman who is like, you know, quote unquote hysteric, and this is the 19th century, because that was like, if anything is wrong with a woman, probably she's hysterical. And so you'd send her into the doctor's office, and in order to properly diagnose her, she would be led into a darkened room, put into like somewhat unnatural position in complete darkness. And then at some random interval, a flash would go off and suspend the subject onto film, and supposedly like the shock of the flash plus, you know, like the state of hysteria would create this image that you could actually use to diagnose cases of hysteria from here on out. You're laughing, but like literally, I mean, this is actually like, one of the fundaments of psychiatry, of modern psychiatry. And so what's interesting about that is two things. I mean, one, of course, like, you know, it's this accumulation of data that we are all like in, you know, in this day and age, like actually kind of familiar with. This accumulation of data in order to build narratives about a certain population. And also what's interesting about that is we get to the point where the where we see metadata, meaning the sheer amount, you don't have to look at these photographs, but the very, very idea that there is a psychiatrist out there who has a dossier of, you know, 12,000 images that he can use in order to diagnose hysteria is actually enough in order to like propel that person's practice. So you get to a point where metadata itself stands in as a proxy for faith in an institution. So fast forward, like, I don't know, 150 years or so, and here we are. And that's 150, right? I don't know, 180 something. There's an excellent, excellent philosopher that I love, Nicholas Diakopoulos, who wrote this really great essay, Algorithmic Accountability. And he mentions a couple of things. Two things, like algorithms do two things successfully. And this is actually, what's interesting about this is that the way that he limbs out what algorithms do map entirely onto the capitalist project itself. So quite frankly, they have a yin and a yang. They have to filter and they have to prioritize. So filtering, of course, like removing the stuff that is not pertinent to you, and prioritizing, bubbling up the stuff that is supposedly pertinent to you. What's interesting about that is even in the title of the report, algorithms are quote unquote black boxes, especially when capitalism is concerned, because you think of Facebook and stuff like that. And actually, if you pick up the newest issue of Points, there's a really, really excellent explanation about that, how that works on Facebook, for instance. All of the inputs, you're not even thinking about which inputs you put into Facebook actually feed into the algorithm in order to bring up the result that is tailored to keep you on Facebook. It's not for your well-being, but it's tailored to keep you on that service. So you get yourself into a feedback loop where you are, the interactions that you're allowed to make on a particular site or service pretty much serve the purpose of just keeping you there on that service, not necessarily giving you back results that might be helpful to you or beneficial to you there. So there's also another really awesome book that I want to give a shout out to, which is called The Inspection House, by Emily Horan and Tim Malley. And so they actually do a lot, they make concrete a lot of the stuff that we've just been talking about by, for instance, talking about technological interventions in metadata, where this kind of thing becomes so apparent that it becomes absolutely disgusting and like so like mind-fuckingly evil that it's almost hilarious. So there's a program that actually piloted in New Jersey, but had been in a couple of other states, called Shot Spotter, where it's, you know, this like really, really like trumped up expensive sensor that is placed on telephone poles, and you can advance it as well. What it does is it's supposed to like use audio to triangulate what's supposed to be gunshots, and then direct police precincts to the point where those gunshots were. And even through, you know, like all of its testing and trial and stuff, they found it not to work. I mean, it gives a lot of like false negatives, and also more importantly, it's redundant, because when people hear gunshots, they have absolutely no problem calling the police. They don't. But yet, when people heard that it was going to be recalled and the program was going to be canceled, someone, even like, you know, a neighborhood resident somewhere actually said, you know, like, I think, you know, law enforcement spends a lot of money on stuff that isn't necessary, but this actually seems necessary. And this is from like a, you know, a neighborhood person. I would rather them know, meaning the police, I'd rather them know where the gunshots are. And it seems that they, he wondered if police wanted to get rid of shot spotters so they didn't have to respond to any gunshots anymore. And so why I found that particular quote jarring is because it just shows that despite, you know, whether something works, whether the metadata is or the data itself is working for you, doesn't matter, because having an algorithm, once again, harkening back to the Charcot and the flash catalepsy, being in control of an algorithm gives or like kind of broadcasts this potency, this power, and leads people into kind of a false sense of security where algorithms themselves are a proxy for trust in an institution of power. And that is something that we always have to push back upon. There's a in the article that I hope you all, or sorry, in the issue that I hope you all read, there's a fascinating article by Don Herrera Helpand called Into the Cave about, you know, the process of giving birth and making the decision to give birth without the drugs and the whatever. This is not something that I'm familiar with. I am not a medical professional. I have no children. Actually, the idea of children kind of aches me out, but we'll see. But I found it really, really interesting because she brought up Hannah Arendt, and she kind of took her to the fore to challenge her about Arendt's, the way that Arendt talks about the public and the private sphere and what belongs there and what belongs there, and how maybe the public, what we experience in the private sphere should not ever come to bear on the public sphere. In the article, which you'll read, you know, she's giving birth and she actually, like, as she's in the delivery room, like, totally, like, freaking out because of the pain and the whatnot and being afraid, of course, because it's her first child. But still in a delivery room in a hospital, she thinks about the ways that these things could be improved and her improvements to be, you know, more, for the process to be more humane include, you know, stuff like dimming the lights a little bit despite, you know, like making it so at least, like, you know, you don't have these glaring lights in your face, or kind of like obfuscating the birth or the vital statistics monitor so it doesn't freak out the, you know, the mother-to-be as she's going through this process. But what's interesting about that is that she's also talking about creating this, you know, like into the cave, like creating this kind of enclosure around herself where she has a space, where she is allowed to be a human animal, like we all are. We're allowed to be human animals, but like totally sheltered and knowing that, doop, cool, thank you. But knowing that it's safe to do so. And so why this is important, and I'll kind of like break it off here, is that even though she takes Arendt to task for maybe kind of throwing us all under the bus, she sketches out a place where there's a public sphere and a private sphere, however, making suggestions on how the, you know, like protocols themselves in hospitals can be made better, carves out a space where you can actually, the human body must do, you know, these like private things and experience pain, and that should be respected. But at the very same time, you're also a citizen that needs to push back on these institutions that govern how your body is treated. And so, yeah, I had some more stuff to say, but we'll leave it at that.
Few slides that I put together because I worried that what I could put together to say might be a little bit belaboring the point, so I thought I would distract you with animated GIFs. Yeah, that usually works.
I can see.
I know, it's really good. They're almost. labyrinth. I don't know what's on my mind. We're all just chasing our own inner goblin ways. So I can maybe just start like riffing on this and that starts to come
there
up. Yep, there it is. So yeah, I think there's a present button in the upper corner that might help, just so that it's not all spoiler. Yeah. It didn't help at all. I broke everything. Oh goodness. Anyway, so I guess I'll just start just for the sake of time. So I mean, I make a lot of art projects that are around infrastructure and relate to surveillance, but I actually was kind of surprised when I got invited to this panel because I generally don't frame it around the concept of privacy. And I think that part of the reason I don't do that is because I don't know if that's the word that we mean half of the time when we say we're talking about privacy. I think that a lot of the time when people are trying to describe like problems related to privacy, they're actually just talking about power negotiations, right? And like, I know this is why there were gifts, because you're like, oh my god, I really don't want to hear someone talk about power. Oh, I mean, bear with, and I'm so sorry, because like I had all of these great pictures of David Bowie to distract you, but I'll try to go quickly. Bear with me. Oh, there they are. So I guess if you can go. All right, so that was me kind of doing my preamble. Next slide was, if you go to the next one, was me explaining why I'm not sure privacy is what we meant, then that one. And then following that was me apologizing. I like how it's loading really slowly. It makes it like super dramatic. But so you can go to the next slide. So I tried a thing where I kind of inspect elemented a bunch of some headlines and tried to like explain what was actually the problem at stake. Because I think sometimes the word privacy gets thrown around when you're talking about like state or corporate actors, and it feels kind of like, is that really the problem? Like, I don't think Sarah Harrison's like, oh, my privacy. It's more like, oh, no, the state wants to murder me dead. And then the next slide, it's like, I'm not really like, oh man, the DEA is like in my privacy. It's like, oh, the DEA could like arrest me for like whatever they feel like and track my movements. Like, that's the problem. It's not really privacy, right? Let's see, next slide. Oh, okay. So this is like, and I feel like one of the reasons that we have a lot of trouble, maybe though people say like they don't care about privacy, and like, because it doesn't have that sort of like effect, you know, it's not something that like has this sort of visceral impact. It's like this very abstracted thing. And one of the things I've been thinking a lot about lately is where can we find examples where it's not abstract, and it is maybe demonstrating how this kind of like information asymmetry and violence scales. So maybe the next slide. Because, you know, that happens, right? And maybe one of the reasons, yeah, I mean, it's happened to me. Anyway. Anyway.
It's not funny, but it's funny when it's Bowie.
Yeah, no, it's funny when it's Bowie. Yeah. But, you know, there's this interesting thing that's been happening online with discussions about online harassment and doxing and the general kind of like unrelenting, like, you know, verbal and real violence that happens to people online who dare to like speak out about anything, that really has a lot of relevant tactics related to privacy violations that happen at the level of state actors. But it's not necessarily understood in the same way. What's the next slide? That's good. Oh, yeah. So basically, like, that is kind of when trying to kind of convey the like concept of privacy and how it affects people, I think a lot about like what your actual threat model is, and if like you're not that concerned about what the state might know about you or what a corporation might know about you, it's because they don't have like a position where they can like do something to you, or you're not sure that they're not the position that you're going to be in. Same thing kind of with like interpersonal relationships. Next slide. Yeah, and in general, this is something that I think, like, it's privacy becomes a weird word to use versus something like power, because, like, it's going to be a different negotiation in every case. Like, I don't really, it's, like, if the power trade-off is, like, I'm going to have to look at a picture of shoes that I just bought for, like, a week after I buy them because I'm going to get a targeted ad about them, like, that is a reasonable, like, negotiation that I would not necessarily consider a privacy violation. Whereas, you know, a friend of mine recently experienced something where she discovered that because she'd given her phone number to Google for two-factor authentication, people who could look at like her contact card or whatever in Google could now call her phone number via Google Voice. And she found this out when a stranger she didn't know called her, soliciting her for job advice, which is like one, like, who the fuck does that? But like,
thirsty,
oh, real,
that's random.
Totes random. You know, also like, that's like a huge vulnerability that could be exploited in really terrible ways. And that's like, again, it's trade-offs, it's different kinds of problems, and you kind of have, and like the use of the word privacy to describe the situation, that situation where like some random person can get your phone number and a situation where someone's going to try to sell you shoes just seems kind of silly to me. It's like, those are just different power problems, they're not privacy problems. Then the last one, I guess, was trying to figure out how to talk about, get back to that Rifkin question, like what would it look like for a society to have more or less privacy. And I feel like what that actually just means is you would just have a society that had very different distributions of power. Like, total transparency presumes that women are never stalked. Total transparency presumes that like the state never kills people. And it assumes that like power is evenly distributed, and that, you know, one person's like shortcoming is not going to cost them their career, but that's not actually how the world works most of the time. So I think that was pretty much all I had, and I thought that was like a good little slide to end on, because it's, you know, a creature riding a dog. So, thanks.
My turn. At first I was excited about going last, and now I kind of wish I had gone first. Harlo told you one of her favorite media stories, so I'll start with one of my favorite law stories. About 15 years ago, in Provo, Utah, the proprietor of an adult video store was prosecuted for obscenity. And some of you will know obscenity law, but one of the things that factors into a prosecution for obscenity is that the state has to show that whatever material this person was producing, sharing, selling, falls outside of contemporary community standards. So the defense lawyer for this adult video store proprietor was sitting in the courtroom, and he looked out the window, and he saw the Marriott sign, that great Mormon hotel chain, and a lightning bolt struck. And he had his investigators go to all the hotels around town and to get information about the use, the renting of adult videos in hotel rooms. And then he went to the cable companies in town and got raw data about how much pornography was being consumed by the fine burghers of Provo, Utah, and then compared that to national figures. And lo and behold, people in Provo, Utah were consuming pornography at a much higher rate than the average. And this didn't take very long for the jury to acquit here. Now, I can assure you that the very same people who you hear in this debate saying, well, I don't worry about surveillance, I haven't done anything wrong, I haven't got nothing to hide, are the people who are in Marriott hotel rooms, or at least were in 2000 before everybody was getting this stuff for free on the internet, watching pornography. And so let's go, I mean, this is, and we've talked about it tonight, you know, the most sort of facile statement that you hear all the time from people in this debate is, I've done nothing wrong, and I've got nothing to hide. You know, Kundera mocked this idea. He called it the lyrical dream of the transparent glass house. I like to say that it's the wrong answer to the wrong question. It's the wrong answer because we all have a lot to hide. We all talk and behave scandalously, and if all of that were available to everybody, it would cause no end of grief. It's the wrong question because, as you've heard from all three of my fellow panelists tonight, privacy isn't fundamentally about secrecy. It's about things like autonomy, we've heard dignity, liberty, power, control, and maybe we'll talk about that later. I want to talk about something else tonight very briefly, and then we'll get to the discussion. Tonight, instead of sort of brushing off the I've done nothing wrong, I have nothing to hide comments, I want to speak in defense of doing wrong. One of my ACLU colleagues, who's a very, very fierce privacy advocate, and some people in the room will know who she is when I tell the story. He emailed me the other day and said she was sick of talking about surveillance and democracy and liberty. She thought it was time for us to talk more about drugs and porn and adultery and gossip. I think these things are connected, by the way. I think those things are connected to the defense of democracy, but I understood where she was coming from. The reason why I think they're connected is that social change often depends on transgressive conduct, and even sometimes breaking the law. And we need privacy in order to leave space for that kind of behavior. The security technologist Bruce Schneier, who many of you will be familiar with, has offered some really good examples of this. Across the United States right now, many, many states are in the process of reversing decades-old laws about homosexuality, for example, about marijuana use. Now imagine if the anti-sodomy laws that were on the books of many, many states until recently, and the drug laws that are still on the books of many states, imagine if they had been perfectly and comprehensively enforced by surveillance, which is now possible. We would never have reached the point where majorities of citizens believe that these behaviors are not actually wrong at all. And so we need to worry. I mean, the perfect enforcement of the law that surveillance technology has now made possible will chill this very important kind of democratic change. And even if we're not personally involved in socially valuable transgressive conduct, we need to worry about surveillance practices that will deter other people from eating. You can imagine enforcing violation against littering or even recycling laws. Is all of this a social good, or is this something that we intuitively are worried about, and why? I mean, you might say that this kind of enforcement could eliminate certain kinds of bias from law enforcement, although I suspect that in practice it wouldn't actually have that effect. But I think it also ignores the complex interplay between social practice and positive law. And this is, I think, what Cicero had in mind when he said, extreme justice is extreme injustice. So before we get to the discussion, I want to close with one more short anecdote. You've probably heard in this post-noted debate that we're having that privacy laws have not kept pace with technology. There are some notable exceptions to that. One of them is for video rentals. Video rentals, for some of you who are too young to know this, it's what we used to do. We were not from big cities, and it was the weekend, and we'd go to a Blockbuster video store and walk around arguing with other people for 45 minutes. Right, it's sort of like that, yeah. So in 1987, Robert Bork was nominated to the Supreme Court. And the Washington City Paper, which is a local paper in DC, managed to go to his video store, get his rental records, and publish them in the Washington City Paper in 1987. 535 members of Congress. By the way, there's nothing scandalous in it at all. They didn't find his adult video store. 535 members of Congress got very, very nervous all of a sudden, and passed a comprehensive video privacy with civil and criminal penalties for the violation of video privacy. And so, you know, I close with that, I think, because, you know, the way to get the attention of people in power about these issues is to demonstrate that they have skin in the game, sometimes literally skin in the game. And maybe then to just sort of launch us into the conversation, I forgot to respond to that foolish statement by Rifkin that you started us with. But I think that it's very historical. You know, I think that he's conflating two ideas of privacy. Exactly. You know, one of them is bodily privacy, and obviously, yeah, I mean, people had a lot less than that until the modern era. But I think information privacy is much more threatened by the current environment than it ever was before. People were always able to whisper to each other, to go into a field, to have palace intrigue. And now, because all of our communication takes place over technology, conversations that never could have been heard in the past are now being recorded in the surveillance time machine. So if anything, I think he's gotten it backwards. Right now, we have less privacy than people have had in the way that we care about the most.
So I think the way we're going
going to do this is I'm going to ask a couple of questions to the group, and people can sort of talk amongst themselves. And then I suspect there are questions in this room. I'm just going to guess that maybe people here will provide us with some further conversation. I went to see Inherent Vice recently, and there were some previews before, and by far my favorite, you know, after American Sniper, was this the latest hacker film, which involved them having to like get this criminal hacker to like help the CIA, because he was the only one who could do it. And it was sort of like running around, and then they're like, he can shut this city down. How can you do that? But the sort of like the premise of this sort of totally ridiculous film was this extreme anxiety about what you can do with digital information, right? That it's possible to be a sort of like all powerful hacker, someone who can like sort of control information that we can't really read very well as citizens. And I thought this was sort of interesting, maybe obvious. And what people have talked about a lot on this panel is the sort of anxiety around those ideas of power and the reality of that power and the way that privacy functions as a way of sort of ignoring that what we're talking about is a sort of top-down power and invasion of privacy. So what I wanted to ask about is a lot of people talked about ways that people who are not extremely powerful might begin to take bits of that power back. So ideas of surveilling the police, for example, and Cop Watch recently has unsurprisingly seen sort of an uptick in participation. And so I was wondering if people might talk about ways in which the power over information collection, which is currently enjoyed by the government and large corporations, might be sort of inverted, and the ways in which data collection from the bottom up is something that we might start to think about, and the invasion of the sort of illegitimate privacy, maybe, of corporations, of government, and what that might look like, and whether our ways of doing that might, in strange ways, as Harlo was talking about, mimic the structure of data collection that is currently top-down. So if we can take really sophisticated photos, so can they. So what does that mean, and how do we begin to sort of build those sorts of relationships? So that's a broad question, but I know something that all of you have already worked on from different angles. So maybe, Harlo, do you want to start?
Sure. From a technical standpoint, I'm actually, like, I have been really enthusiastic about, and this might be, like, so nerding out, but I'm really enthusiastic about kind of, like, roll your own or, like, small batch artisanal data ownership.
Roll your own.
Yeah. I mean, there are, for instance, the Diaspora Project is an alternative social network. Well, I mean, like, we all know about, like, Elo. Elo had, like, its moment, and I don't know, maybe it's doing really, really well. I mean, like, that's cool.
It seems like they encoded, because everyone got on, yeah. Like,
yeah, so, yeah. I'm like, oh, I have to do a new account now. Yeah. But, I mean, where Elo kind of sucked in my eyes, I thought Diaspora kind of did a good thing because it allows you to host these kind of like little like insular planets of data that you and your friends and like people you know or are associated with like have physical ownership of. There's also groups that practice this as like a business model. So for instance, there's a group called Green Host, which practices data ownership as like a political act. They host and kind of like foster the technological growth of small-time activist communities. And this is a model that you can kind of replicate with a bit of know-how, just like being able to hold your own data in, you know, like control it in your own servers in your own way and be able to like, even, you know, if you want to capitalize on it and market it or whatever, and exchange that for some sort of like financial or economic gain, that's cool, but it's on your own terms. And I think that it's promising to see that happening. And I think it will gain traction if it's properly supported.
So, just following up on that, I think, I mean, so part of the idea that here is, how do we take control over our own information. And one way to think about that is to think about information as like fuel, like energy. And you can think about big data. So when we talk about big data, we can be talking about just the collection of information. You know, there's a shitload of information. We can be talking about the mathematical techniques for extracting knowledge from that information. But we can also be talking about big data with capital letters. That is, big data, the corporations that use those mathematical techniques to extract information from and to use it as a proxy for trust, perhaps. And you know, for their business model, which is a business model that I participate in, and you know, the NSA, I suppose, using the same techniques to further their business model. But the point that I'm trying to make here is that if you think about big data like big oil, like big data in the capital, you know, and then think about the attempts that we're trying, that many of you in this room are probably trying to do in very small ways, or maybe large ways. Trying to take control of your own use of the resource of energy resources, right? Trying to do it in a way that you know allows you to have some say on how you utilize energy, whether you're using solar power or biking or what have you, right? So that you have some control over it. Now, those you know the sorts of things I was talking about. I mean, in a way, I'm just sort of metaphorically saying that there is a model, right? There's a model. And if you think about energy and information as being resources that we have, right, that are out there to be shared, to be manipulated, to be controlled, well, we do have resources in small ways fighting back. And I can't speak about it technically, but I can speak about it in a way that a philosopher can, which is, well, just a lot of hot air. I don't know, but there you go.
One concern that I have, I totally love those projects and I love that model, but I do worry about how many people don't have the means to speak to it technically. Like, not insofar, like, not to say, like, oh, like, it should be better, but I think sometimes there's a tendency in trying to encourage people to try and, like, fight back or, like, protect themselves. There's a lot of, like, shaming that goes around, like, lacking a certain technical literacy that it's, like, important to try and kind of counteract as much as possible. Sarah Jong has a really funny line about this. She once said that she only like shames corporations that have bad information security because they can afford it. Because there is like there's a weird right. sort of like tenet, like and I think that
I totally agree. However, I think like in terms of scale, I'm not necessarily thinking about it in the individual level. I'm not mm-hmm. saying like, hey, like you over there,
yeah.
like
right.
you
yeah.
like run your data server, obviously yeah. dummy. But what I'm saying is that like, you know, if your, I don't know, if your community, if your bike co-op or your coven or whatever, like actually says like, I have, you know, like we have this data, who, like how much is it worth to you? I would like to see them given the infrastructure in order to proffer it.
Yeah. I mean, I think maybe it's more to the point that like on an individual level, like the services that we don't like that have this
yep.
data improving their own ability to protect it is kind of crucial as well.
Yeah, I mean, maybe just one observation here. You know, in 1971, a bunch of anti-war activists broke into an FBI field office outside of Philadelphia, stole all the files, put them in a suitcase, you know, drove home and mailed them to the Washington Post and sort of launched the surveillance debate of the 1970s. That was a lot of work. Now, you know, someone can put on headphones, pretend to be listening to a Lady Gaga CD and take hundreds of thousands of State Department cables in an air-conditioned tent in Iraq, and that takes a couple hours. To do so. So in that sense, yeah, I mean, there's huge asymmetries, but it's also, from the point of view of the state of these institutions, they're a lot more vulnerable to individuals. Now, some of these individuals are people who many of us in this room admire, people like Manning and Snowden, but there are other individuals who engage in that kind of conduct for reasons that are far more admirable. And so, yeah, I mean, I do think that the power and vulnerability issues are a little bit more complex than, you know, they have all and we have none. I think they sort of might be better understood as, are we going to try to improve security for everybody on these networks, which will mean that we can't do as much surveillance, but which will mean that we're not as vulnerable to these kinds of attacks that we either like or don't like.
Well, I just following up on that, I think that's exactly right, that it's certainly not right that we should think about, and perhaps my analogy might have led you to think that I was thinking that, well, you know, there's big oil and, you know, they're bad, you know. Well, in fact, you know, we're all like, you know, like a lot of us drive cars and we, you know, enjoy our heat and things like that. The question is, how do you, you know, look, energy is a necessary resource for the way we live in this room right now. And so the question is, how do we, you know, in a fair and just way, distribute that resource in our society? And the same is true with information. Right? I mean, there's, you know, one idea that I like to think about is the notion of epistemic equality, where, you know, the idea that we want to be able to sort of have, if you think about information and knowledge as a resource, how do we sort of get people to access that resource, have the capability of accessing it in some sort of equal way? And that, that incorporates our ability to control it, and also to deal with people that are going to exploit it for their own, sometimes very nefarious purposes.
There was one idea actually in an article in The Nation about the way that a number of companies, but the easiest example is Google through Gmail, collects your information to use it to sell ads, right? So you'll notice that the ads alongside your Gmail have something to do with your interests, sometimes an uncanny amount to do with your interests. And this is because, of course, like all of the data from your email is being collected, and it's not being gone through by humans. Of course, it's being gone through by algorithms. Algorithms are this sort of black box, as described by many of the speakers. And the way that Google is allowed to do this is, you know, they're like, of course, it's not surveillance. People aren't reading your email. It's just a program, right? And so the proposal that this writer made was that those algorithms, those programs, should be considered legal agents. So the way that a doctor is a legal agent of a hospital, like if the doctor does, you know, commit some horrible malpractice, the hospital is going to have to pay. In the same way, if a program spies on you, the company should be accountable. This is not actually something that has been tried, to my knowledge, as a legal argument, but this was a theory of a legal argument that could be made. And so I'm curious sort of from the panel about two things. One of the things that happens when we allow programs to do things like this is we get a lot of stuff that we want, you know, like the ads are things we're interested in, but also the services in theory are tailored to what we as consumers want. The other is the question of sort of black box algorithms. How do you think about a democratically controlled algorithm? If Google, rather than Bing, is what we all use, maybe we want some say over how that functions, what types of results it brings forward. And so those are two somewhat different questions, but linked, I think. And so I was wondering if you guys would like to dive into that.
I mean, it's a tough question simply because currently, and we're all used to this, and we're so used to it to the point where like it'll be really, really hard to change it. Terms of services for things for products that you use, i.e. Google or, you know, iTunes or whatever, I mean, have really, really great limited liability clauses within them that prevent that, like, I mean, just prevent bringing any of these corporations to any kind of accountability like you described. And also there is no, like, there's no recourse or pushback in, you know, contemporary legalese, you know, in Washington, D.C. or any other place that would counter that. So it's either like you just kind of have to burn Google to the ground and start anew, or you find ways of working within, you know, the margins of how you use Google in order to kind of like make that work to your satisfaction. I don't particularly see those services changing in any way that might make that project more realizable, though.
So I'm not going to take on this legal theory. That's where I could get into trouble. I mean, on one level, the idea that Google's computers are reading my Gmail, for me, it's a fairly trivial concern compared to a lot of other things. I do think, though, that there are ways of looking at it that are problematic. So, Google knows a lot about me from multiple platforms. And if all of that information sort of goes into targeting ads, so for example, we know that there's research about when people feel most insecure about their physical appearance, right? It tends to be on Monday mornings or something like that, right? So what if these things are sending you beauty product ads, diet ads at that time? And so, there's a level of manipulation that is really not transparent. You don't know what's going on. Again, would you say that's a privacy violation? Is it something else? It certainly is something that makes me uncomfortable when I think about that I might be getting served up ads that are based not just on keyword searches, but on all kinds of other information that this company has on me. What if someone looks over your shoulder doesn't read your email, but sees the ads that are served up? You're 15, and it's your father looking over your shoulder. Yeah, it does happen. I'm saying, this kind of thing happens all the time, and we think of the privacy violation as being reading the email, but seeing the ads might in fact give a lot of information about what the person is talking about. And I think the question, we had a slide on algorithmic accountability. I actually think that's going to be a big question going forward. And one of the ways people experience this now, sort of pre-big data already, is in credit scores. Probably a lot of people either have had this happen to themselves or know somebody who had a low credit score for reasons that were not transparent, possibly erroneous, and there wasn't really a clear way to get out of it, which is why a lot of privacy scholars, use the Kafka analogy rather than the Orwell analogy for this kind of thing. There's this invisible process that has real-world consequences, no clear way for you to correct error, but you're actually suffering consequences because you're being given a score that might tell you what kind of loan you're able to get, or other kinds of opportunities. When the government does this, it might decide what security line you go in at the airport, and you can see those kinds of things growing. But I do think that there's going to be a collision at some point between, actually you do see it. So for example, in the context of what we call revenge porn, Google, probably a lot of people appreciate this, is quietly manipulating its algorithms to get that stuff not to appear on front pages. They did this for mugshot websites that where people took public mugshots, put them on the web, and then charged people to have them removed. I mean, Google basically...
Well, notably, to begin with,
right.
Google has built its algorithm to filter porn in general out of the front page results, unless that's expressive.
So I mean, I think that there are times when we sort of secretly cheer this result because it gets us out of having to deal with very, very naughty legal issues. They say it's their whole business, it's proprietary, how can they have to make it transparent? And then you see people being very affected by it, I think that's going to be one of the very interesting issues going on over the next few years.
Sometimes I feel that the anxiety around algorithms is kind of a bit of misdirection because they are this black box, and it's not like you can go do a code review and it's like, oh, that's where the mistake happened. That's when you had intent.
Anyone can.
Yeah, you can just read this. It's gonna be super easy. It's just like reading a terms of service, which we all do every time we sign something. There's a way in which you could kind of look instead to maybe the superstructures that require and reinforce the existence of this of the kind of expectation that we kind of live with this algorithm. Credit scores are an interesting example. Martha Poon, who's a researcher at Dan Societies, has been doing this history of FICO, and she can't look at the actual algorithm that makes your FICO score. So it's what that actually means is looking at what are the institutions that need FICO to work for them to work. And what are the exploit points in that? What are the mechanisms that make it so that we can't escape FICO? And what would it look like to kind of get outside of that? And I feel like that's maybe harder to do with Google right now, or seemingly harder to do, but is maybe a method of approach that's a little more tangible.
I'm not sure that the black box issue, I agree, is not really about, not just about privacy. I mean, you think about what we were talking about Google. I mean, think about Google Complete. Google Complete is the nifty tool that allows when you're searching on Google, right, it finishes your sentences, right? Mm-hmm. Finishes your for your search. It knows me so well, right? And so you search privacy and Snowden, right? And it'll just tell you, right? Knowledge and power. You know,
that, I mean, because that's what, you know, that's what Lynch wants to know, right? You know, that's,
you know, knowledge and Lynch, right? Oh, sorry. you know, but I mean, there is this, I mean, look, what is interesting about that is that it's incredibly great. It's so useful. We use it all the time. It's so, especially, you know, when you're doing using your phone, it's just so much more convenient. However, that sort of shapes how we access information. And so what's really interesting about that is that it's sort of pre-screening things for us. It's saying, this is really what you want to know. And most of the time, frequently enough, it is. And I think, well, boy, it's maybe, you know, what sort of thing would be try and trick? Knowledge and Michael Jordan. You know? I mean, it's sort of like, you know, well, so part of what really interests me about Black Box is what it's doing for our perception of the world, what it's doing for our filtering mechanisms in our mind. I don't know if you guys saw this about a year ago, 2 years ago, College Humor, this website that I've never actually seen but people told me about. they did this thing, video called What If Google Was a Guy? Right? And it was really great. Piece because it was like just showed Google sort of like a bureaucrat, like an old guy like myself, just sort of up there, and he's like carrying, he has like stuff on his desk, and people are coming up and asking him like all these really creepy questions, right? And he's getting completely like fed up. Okay, right, okay, porn, there, okay. And eventually he's like, come on, can't you ask me a real question? Well, the funny thing is, of course, what's funny about that is we don't think he's not a guy. But we do treat Google as this sort of source, this sort of all-knowing thing that we can just ask questions of, and it seems to already know what we're looking for. What's it doing for us as a society? A little off topic, but nonetheless, what you have.
Oh, yeah, well, I made a funny joke to myself, but I'll keep that.
private joke.
No, it was just I met Google and she's black. It's
right.
Black.
Well, I think that's exactly. Yeah, that's precisely.
But actually, I wanted to get back to what you had said about this kind of because these systems are closed and because they're for-profit companies that can change their terms of services because they. They don't answer to us. Like, they're not beholden to us. That's okay. That's how things work. It's fine. But they do these, kind of behind-the-scenes tweaking of their algorithms in order to bring about what they feel is, more representative of the values that they, as a company, want to push forward. And so as much as, it's so cool to, make fun of Google, I actually respect them a lot because in the past, decade or so, we've seen them go through these growing pains where, as a company, they've had to respond to these issues in ways that are not necessarily so clean or black and white, and that's okay. And that's super okay, and that's super postmodern or we're post-postmodern, but you know what I mean? That's that is the most realistic way that we're going to have to deal with data is to not remember that algorithms can run amok. But ultimately, algorithms are written by human beings, and human beings ultimately should retain the ultimate say. And that calls in the democratic process because Google has listened to what people say about, for instance, the right to be forgotten, and then worked that into, their the right to be forgotten, meaning that. Even though when, you Google yourself and you get your mugshot from, sophomore year, you have, or you could, well, actually, it's not about some mugshot, but you know, if you have like a bad reputation on Google, or you're the victim of like, you know, some sort of Google bombing where people are like putting certain results about you that might be erroneous to the core of your search results, you can petition to have those things placed lower in the rankings. So even though that's like, according to the internet, the most prominent result about you and thus the unmitigated truth, there is, you know, a human check in place, a check and balance in place, in order to make sure that these results are like a humane response of what Google wants to be on the internet. And I agree to that, because I think that any, and I get into like fights with like, you know, internet people, serious internet people, about this all the time, whether or not like, you know, the right to be forgotten rule is ethical or not. And like, I guess no, it's not ethical in an algorithmic sense. It's actually like you're manipulating it, you're feeding like false data into it. However, we don't live at the service of algorithms, you know?
Okay, I think we can take questions. Yeah. Okay, I want to raise this question to the panelists. I want to hear your opinion about trust. I'm making a metaphor here. I think it's like when you're dating someone, the reason you want to be with someone is that this feeling of being understood, that he knows what, that this other person knows what you like, what you don't like, makes you feel convenient. And this convenience and dependency, do you think we are responsible for doing that? Because everything seems to be so good until it goes wrong. We use Google or Bing or the emails. We use every day, we choose to use it. And we choose to use Gmail instead of these other things because it's more useful. Do you think we're spoiled by this feeling of trust?
Well, I would actually counter that with the question, do you know how it might feel, or do you know the signs of when your trust is being abused, or when
yes.
something is going wrong?
Yes.
I just
want to raise this question, like, this trust, this algorithm, it's human as well.
The question is how, in this circumstance, what are those metrics? How do we think about the violation of trust when we've come to rely on a service that is supposedly giving us a set of things that adapt to our needs for the trade-off of showing us ads? But actually, the trade-off is something more than that and often less understood. So like, what are the signs? What do you look for? How do you think about it?
I mean, trust, I think, is a large part of our experience with the, just Google, but the internet. I mean, I think one of the really interesting things that I've been thinking about my own experience with the internet is that it's sort of become cognitively seamless for me. And what I mean by that is that it's become more and more, interacting with the internet is more and more like what perception is sort of like. It's just sort of, I have default, you know, and when I perceive the world, I know that my vision can trick me, right? I can violate my trust. You know, I mean, it violates my trust all the time. But I still have to rely on it. Right? It's sort of like the default is trust. Because, you know, that's just the way it is. Conversations like that too, you know, like I know people are going to bullshit me, but default is, you know, you're interacting, asking because somebody where, you know, the restaurant is, your default is sort of trust. Right now, I think what's really interesting about Google knowing, or, you know, sort of the knowledge that we go through with the internet, is that it's sort of this sort of really fast perception-like experience that we've become increasingly sort of, the default is trust. We know it can go wrong, and we know that it'll steer us wrong. We know that, you know, it's going to violate, you know, but the default, it's because it's just the way that we interact with the world.
Are you saying that we are defending our privacy, we are actually defending our right to trust?
Yeah, well, I think there's a really big connection, yeah. So, you know, I get worried as a philosopher about what we mean by rights in this context, but yeah, more or less, that's what I'm talking about.
Okay.
Well, just in a slightly different context, you know, in the context of the debate that we're having about the security state in the last year and a half, you know, trust is a really critical currency for a security state in a democracy. And so much of what we hear from government officials is, trust us. We understand that this gives us access to tremendous power, but we're actually pretty good people following pretty strict rules. And that's why I think the most potent bit of video that we've seen in the last year and a half was not Snowden introducing himself. It was James Clapper under oath saying to Congress, we don't collect any information on millions of Americans, at least not willingly, we don't, which was played in the loop over and over again. And so it wasn't just that information was being concealed from the public that never should have been concealed. It was that you know, the officials who asked for our trust violated it by lying to us in the context of democratic oversight. And so I think, you know, as a civil libertarian, I say that when you are looking at institutions of power, your default has to be mistrust. And we have to build systems that enforce rules rather than relying on trust because the asymmetries are so great, the temptations are so strong, and the history is full of examples of trust being absolutely abused.
Like the Stasi.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
They put cameras in everything. I went to that museum last summer, and like seriously, it's like, oh, like here's a camera in a sewing kit. Oh, here's a camera in a fucking batch of logs.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
I keep thinking about, oh, sorry, this is a tangent, just how, like, I mean, the Stasi Museum's in the former headquarters of the secret police in East Berlin, and I keep trying to imagine, like, what does that look like, you know, 20, 30 years down the line in the United States? Like, when do we turn Guantanamo into a museum, and like,
sadly, probably yes.
Can I just pick up on the trust thing? Like, it seems to me, like, just to go back to that Rifkin point. I mean, I think that, you know, you're exactly right. You're exactly right in kind of criticizing some simplicities and so on. But it seems to me like one thing that builds trust in normal human relations is face-to-face interaction. Is in fact the social, knowing the other person, the structures of accountability. There's kind of repeated interactions and so on. And actually, one of the big things at the moment on the internet is privacy being a way of hiding oneself,
yeah.
Like anonymity. Like we're talking about, you know, stalking, for example. I mean, online stalking, or you know, what happened to someone like Mary Beard. You know, these kind of attacks. That anonymity is what is permitting this kind of behavior. So it seems to me like, actually, if we're thinking about trust. We do want to, and we think about the initial question of what, you know, what is lost by having more privacy and what's gained. It seems to me like actually there's a kind of a reliance, we rely on a sociality to develop trust in the first place. And one of the things we Google, we don't know who they are. You know, there's no one to go to and say, have you been doing this? It's a faceless organization. Facelessness is itself a problem for trust, it seems to me.
Absolutely. I mean, quick detour, if any of you guys are, as we talk about Snowden and how he originally reached out to the journalists that he did, is he chose those who he knew he could trust to use, you know, PGP, which is, encryption, public key encryption. So public key encryption really quickly is like you have a private key. You have a public key. You give your public key to people, and then they use your public key to encrypt messages that are total gobbledygook to everybody but you. And the way that you like exchange these things is you have a key party, which is not what you think, but it's actually you know, you write down on a piece of paper the, like, you know, 40 characters that make up your PGP fingerprint. And you give it to someone physically, and they look at that, and they look at you, and they answer on a computer. How well can you verify that you know that this, like, string of 40 characters equals that person that you see before you? And you answer honestly, because that's how you take the human value of trust and translate that into something machines can use. And when we, everybody needs to kind of remember that. And it's like such an old idea. It's been around since the 90s, last Thursday.
Even maybe before that.
Oh gosh, that's so wrong. I'm so sorry, Twitter. But you know what I mean? I mean, it's an old idea, but it's a valid one. And Snowden chose that because it's kind of tried and true. It's been the one thing that hasn't been broken, which is this human capability to trust.
I feel like what we've been talking a lot about in this panel is a fear of corporations either abusing or manipulating their knowledge around our data. Well, not to say that corporations aren't involved in this, but I'm actually even a little more afraid of our personal abuse around what we know about our bodies, for example. I have a lot of coworkers who have these bracelets that track their sleeping habits, datifying your own your bodily functions, which of course is provided as a service and an app to track how you might better live or whatever you have, and that data is used by someone in some effect. But it kind of makes me wonder: do we owe ourselves privacy to ourselves? I kind of don't want to know. I'm very afraid of knowing how my body works, and I wonder if that is, or I just to deny the fact that I have a body at all. How do you counteract your relationship to privacy when it's about not so much sharing things about yourself, but knowing yourself in a quantified way?
Okay, so one thing that I find interesting is walking around the city when I'm taking the subway. If you guys have seen those posters for this healthcare marketplace called Oscar, which is new, which is interesting, really interesting, and you can imagine every other state has similar programs. But Oscar, one of their ads says sign up for Oscar, you'll get a free Fitbit, and that will, it's kind of buying a pair of skinny jeans for free or something, I don't know, where you're equating your activity that you can monitor with this bracelet that your health insurance plan will give you. And the trade-off is that you will get certain rebates or whatever on stuff that reflect how well you're doing here on the wrist. And we think about, that rebate, that's awesome. I would love, a discount on this gym membership. However, what you're giving up is you are actually giving them a 100% clear tunnel into your day-to-day movements. And it gets to the point where, and this is happening in various corporations, literally around the globe are piloting programs exactly like these that use biometric data in order to, on the fly, algorithmically generate how much you're going to pay in premiums this month on your health insurance, on your car insurance. There's a little dongle that you can get from InState or whatever, and it will show how conscious of a driver you are at any point. And once you do that, ask any question that you might want to know about a data set and you can do it. It's automatically there. It's not really helpful to be afraid of it and to pretend it doesn't exist, because you're gonna know about it anyway. You will see it reflected in your bill every month.
Yeah, exactly.
So it behooves all of us to kind of just be educated about where that comes from.
This also ties into a bigger debate around the Internet of Things.
Right? Oh, totally.
Exactly.
Oh, I can't wait to write
the
outline for that.
Exactly. I mean, we might say the Internet of Us right now, because one of the things about the Internet of Things, about these little bracelets, is we're starting to treat you start thinking about the Internet of Things and you start thinking about the cognitive seamlessness we were talking about before, and pretty soon we're just one of the things in the Internet of Things.
Does everyone feel like they know what we mean by the Internet of Things?
So
Some, yes, some no.
Those little bracelets. So.
Well, not just bracelets, but I mean, part
the little devices.
The world of physical objects.
Text that have internet connection.
I mean, technically, it was a term used to describe like creating a protocol for networked objects, but networked objects apparently doesn't convey what it is well enough, so we're using this term that like is very confusing.
There's, I guess, probably the most like popular example of this was with the cars, right? Like the there's a big, and I guess it depends how we want to define it for the purpose of this conversation, but the big New York Times article was about how if you have a low credit score, actually you could buy a car, you would be making payments on the car, but the car had a device in it such that if you missed a payment, they could turn off, they could shut down your car, they could prevent you from starting your car. And of course, like the best possible example of why this is horrible is like mom needs to take her kid to the hospital, she's missed a car payment, the car won't start. Right? So
although
the idea that a
there was
range of things can be connected and you know, people have a really deep reach or companies have a deep reach into your life. But yeah.
I was just going to mention, I mean, it doesn't detract from your point at all about the abuse and misuse, but recently there was a kidnapping of a young woman in Philadelphia, and she like literally grabbed off the street, put into a trunk, and like was probably going to be murdered. But she was located because the guy who kidnapped her was a person who had such bad credit and such a car that they could lowjack his car and find him. And get her out of the trunk. But I mean, these are like
there were not a supportive example.
No.
Thanks.
Well, okay. So this actually kind of reveals our ambivalence toward these technologies, because I mean, as much as like I actually like philosophically am 100% behind, you know, protecting our rights as consumers and citizens and all these things, there are, I'm not afraid of like organizations like law enforcement actually, you know, like digging in and kind of hacking shit when people need to be saved and things need to get done. And I think that's kind of like that's outside of the model that we're talking about.
Although there's this like sort of preposterous extreme of an argument for these sorts of devices when the new iPhone came out with encryption and I think it was an NSA spokesperson gave an interview to the New York Times that was like really extraordinary. He's like this iPhone is like, and if you like, if your daughter was kidnapped and like you couldn't break down the door,
and you're not Liam Neeson,
this is what the iPhone is, and this series like really like overly literal metaphor. It's like no, it's like houses have doors, and, like that was you know. But anyway,
and also I mean like it's one of those things where they're looking in the wrong place for their solution. Like I mean the answer to, you know, like in, I don't know, like better law enforcement is not like having insecure devices for everyone where like everyone can just be totally like, you know, personality or like identity theft ahoy. Like, I mean, that's what they're hoping, but actually if they were just kind of better at their job, they'd be able to get stuff done regardless. So, I mean, yeah, we're not trying to like antagonize them in that way, you know?
Oh, okay.
Hello.
Yeah,
go for it.
Thanks. So if you were a citizen in East Germany in the early 1980s or under apartheid South Africa or any kind of surveillance state, or if you were like a violent terrorist part of an IRA shell at that time, and if you were under surveillance by an agent and you could hear the clip on the phone line when you're on the phone, knowing that you're being tapped, and you could tell that your letters were being intercepted, and you knew that you were under surveillance, and that fed into my idea that being watched would make you act differently as a political agent. Like, was it the idea that there was another conscious human being watching you, or was it the material incursion on your day-to-day life that made you change your behavior? So I'm just thinking about, is it the idea that it's the algorithm that's not a human being watching you that doesn't distress us anymore? Or is it the idea that it's invisible? Do you see that distinction that I'm Because that's the paradigm of surveillance that we're afraid of, right? Like, that's the reason we don't have spies on, because we don't want to be attacked.
I think you can go a little bit too far with the analogies to the Stasi, at least where we are right now.
But I
think it's important to make this point, because when you combine a surveillance state with an authoritarian government, that's not the same thing as combining these surveillance capabilities with what most people experience as not an authoritarian government. And those kinds of accounts don't resonate with people because they're not living in a world where that thing that's overheard is going to have them carted off to a cell, unless they're in certain communities who have experienced this much more. So I actually think that there's a great danger that the kind of capabilities that we've created right now will lead us down a road like that. And the hypothesis that people use, it's called turnkey tyranny, right? I mean, what's protecting us from being a Stasi are a set of rules. How robust are those rules? Well, we don't know, because what will happen if there's another traumatic terrorist attack? What will happen if there's a war that actually does endanger people rather than just being a television spectacle? Will those rules withstand that kind of threat? We don't know, and that's why we need to be careful. But I think to sort of say, the difference is this is computers and that was people. The bigger difference is that those were profoundly authoritarian governments with powers over citizens that we actually don't, that our government doesn't have now. And the risk of mass surveillance, the kind of passive collection that's going on of all this information, is a different risk, I think, than what you had with the Stasi and you were going to be carried away. I think over time, it may be a similar risk. I think that Michael used the term attractive nuisance. These are databases of ruin. If you build it for one person purpose, they're going to be used for other purposes. I think there's risks of major due process violations. I think it can chill our conduct in the long run. But I think that it's important for us it's instructive to look at those historical examples to see how these capabilities could be used, but that's actually not how they're being used here.
Yes.
I think that's not how they're being used here a lot of the time, but it is kind of valuable to acknowledge like that it has and does happen.
Yes, and when it happens, when it happens, it's illegal. So I mean, so this
that
is
that doesn't
the,
mean that doesn't really undo it.
No, it doesn't.
It doesn't really change it.
It does change it. I think, and listen, believe me, I spent my career trying to prevent the little brother abuses as well as the big brother abuses, and I do think that if you have these databases, they're going to be used by cops to stalk their ex-girlfriends, they are. I mean, we saw a few examples from the NSA, but this happens all the time with local police departments and local sheriff departments, that these technologies are used for awful, awful purposes. But that's different than having two-thirds of the population acting as spies for the government.
Absolutely.
And having no political freedoms at all across the spectrum, and no ability to organize politically to change those systems. I mean, that's the hallmark of a totalitarian regime, where any attempt to organize, to change it, can immediately be halted by force and coercion. I don't think that we're there yet. I think the places where it might have felt like that were in some Muslim communities after 9/11. And I think individuals have suffered those abuses, but systemically, it's different.
So for the optimist, I agree.
I think that's right. There is an important difference there, and I agree with that. But the danger is what's coming. But the thing that's sort of weird about our present situation is that, look, the Stasi needed to get 200. They needed to get to observe my behavior. They needed all these people.
Right.
Right. It was boots on the ground, literally. And the interesting question now is that whether governments can achieve some of the same effects without needing those boots on the ground, without needing all those folks. That in a sense, we think about the incidental collection of data, right? The just sort of like, well, we've got the stuff, we're not really targeting you, but we collect some stuff about you, and then we can store that incidentally collected information. The NSA can do, and then that sits there, that pool, right? Now, what I think is worrying is the fact that that fact alone, that information is being stored in that pool, can have a sort of chilling effect and can change some behavior. get certain people worried about what they're doing, get them to monitor their own behavior in ways that, you know, might be very small, but might add up to a large systemic problem when it's writ large in society.
I absolutely agree that there's a long-term chilling effect and we don't know how it will play out. But just that example itself shows how different the
situation is. No, I agree.
Well, it's interesting that this is a very, like, I think a lot of this conversation has taken an assumption of like a very domestic policy analysis of what states can do.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, perhaps it is a different panel discussion to have about whether or not the fact that, you know, if the defense is that this is surveillance practices that are being performed, like, not on American citizens, and that's somehow better, I think that's questionable. And how it's played out, like, yeah, we don't need boots on the ground to be doing a lot of this work anymore because we have drones. And
exactly.
Is that actually much
right.
better, right?
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, I think exactly.
And, you know, sometimes American citizens do get killed in that context as well, as we all know, and sometimes their sons.
I'm
going to
take a few questions.
It seems to me that there are two general sets of conversations that have been going on. One is, given that we have these technologies and we all want some new things, amazing things, like access to millions of people, interconnectivity, massive search power, given that we have all this potential, what would be the kind of ideal system to leverage it, while not suffering the sorts of dehumanizing or alienating effects that have been described? And that's like one set of conversations that have been going on. The other set of conversations are big corporations like Google and big governments, whether they're the US government or the Stasi or whoever, are fucking with us in ways we don't like. And in the same really ways, and the things we don't like about what they're doing to us are actually very similar to the things that states and corporations have been doing to us independently of these sorts of technologies that are on the table. And so I guess, is it a good idea, I guess is my question, for more and more, if there are young folks, you know, who want to go into the world of solving problems, should everyone be going into the world of information privacy? Should folks be focusing on information privacy? You know, and like, if the problem really is like what Google does, or the problem is the US Congress, there are sets of tools that have nothing to do with information privacy that have been mentioned in this conversation as the actual solutions. So is it a good idea to actually group this whole set of issues under one paradigm?
That's like the metadata question.
I think
we're gonna just take a few since we're towards the end and then we can sort of address them all together.
So one thing, I wonder to what degree you think the interests of big institutional actors are served not just by their actual surveillance capabilities, but by posturing, you know? Like, I mean, I'm thinking mainly of the fact that for all the NSA's enormous amassing of power and building crazy things in the Utah desert, you know, there was a recent article in the New Yorker, like, they haven't really done that much, you know, effectively, at least that we know of,
no
exercising.
No matter how many needles you have, you still have a haystack.
Right, and, but I wonder how much they're really just served by just the appearance of omnipotence. You know, similarly, like, Google, we believe that Google is the best thing that is in Google's corner is that we believe that Google is perfect mastery of all knowledge. How much do you think that that serves them? How much do you think that that is actually true?
Awesome. Thank you. And I had
it's a really like sloppy point / question stemming off of the story about the woman in Philadelphia who was kidnapped. A friend of mine was telling me that story and was basically like the only reason she was found is because she was like walking by like a really fancy high school in like in the white part of Philadelphia in which they have these like really fancy CCTV closer cameras that could like find her and then, you know, like that happened. Whereas like the only kind of surveillance you have in the hood are like these porta panopticons set up by police to surveil black people to make sure that we're like understanding what they're doing. And it just so happens that this is also a person who's very active on Twitter and gets like abuse. She's a black woman, gets abuse from like white supremacist men like nonstop, and really has no recourse in which to like protect herself in that sense. So I guess my sloppy question is basically, how do we, can we really like conceive of privacy and then like the access to the capacity to like do anything with information, or even like the access of like people, regular people, to that like capabilities, right? The capabilities of protecting yourself or manipulating information. Like, can we actually like conceive of that in any sort of universal way without dealing with issues of like equality?
Okay, forgive me, I'm gonna take one last question because there are so many, and then we'll.
It might actually build off of another question. I wanted to add in terms of the utility of us thinking about privacy with a capital P, also the relationship of privacy between persons, so interpersonal privacy. And whether or not we should start, it's actually like it's been generally agreed upon that privacy is obviously a word that we're using that's serving as a stand-in for other things that we want to address: freedom of expression, safety, security, freedom of thought. So whether or not it would be more useful to think about things also like in one sense in terms of information flows, but also in terms of the privacy that we're trying to protect or the type.
So you guys have a lot to work with.
Yeah, maybe everyone can choose what they want.
Yeah.
We have a menu. Yeah.
We have a menu. We can hang out afterwards. Yeah.
Well, I'll start with like a low ball answer, which is I think that a lot of these questions kind of demonstrate how we're talking, like ostensibly we're talking about technologies, but actually we're talking about just kind of systems of technologies, which incorporate the law and culture as much as they incorporate the actual technologies themselves. So in order for any of these things to actually do us as citizens any good, you do have to allow for these cases where, you know, actually, like, had there not been CCTV there, that person would never get on the news, because we all know the bias against like black women who get kidnapped versus white women. Or, yeah, the fact that a LoJack like actually ended up catching, you know, a would-be killer. With, might we add, had like, you know, a crazy extensive criminal background that should have been flagged by other technologies in the first place. And so you have to, I mean, we, yeah, our only hope is that, you know, we'll have the legal and cultural infrastructure in order to kind of shape technology in ways that actually help us. And that's just kind of a lowball start.
Maybe I'll take on the question of whether these massive institutions are just projecting the appearance of power, or whether they're powerful. You know, when you, in the context of corporations, they surely project more power than they have. That's why we have tech bubbles, and probably why we're in one now. But they do have real power. I think in the context of state power, and I thought that New Yorker piece was really on point. If you judge these institutions based on the criteria that they use to defend themselves, they're massive failures. And you know, the metric that they use is how many terrorist attacks did we prevent. You can't prevent terrorist attacks. They're absolutely rare and random events that don't have common characteristics or features. And it doesn't matter how many surveillance capabilities you have, you don't stop something like what happened in Boston, what happened in Paris. It's simply not possible. And that's why they start with the number 54, they go down to one, and that New Yorker piece did a great job of taking apart that one. On the other hand, if state surveillance were useless, it wouldn't be dangerous. And I think it is dangerous. And it's dangerous not because of its predictive capabilities, which are really, really slim, but because of its forensic value. Basically, if you collect all of this information about human movements, behaviors, interactions, conduct, you're creating a surveillance time machine that allows you to hit rewind. So that if I come under suspicion 5 years from now or 8 years from now, the government can have a complete record of everything that I've done in the interim. And right now, that capability rests with a couple of spy agencies. But as this technology gets much, much cheaper, every country will have it. Every police agency will have it. And again, from the point of view of the person whose only job it is to catch the kidnapper, this is all good news. But from the point of view of the public with a Bill of Rights, it was written to make the job of law enforcement more difficult, not easier, because of concerns that aggregating power will crush democracy. This is really, really terrifying. The idea that every local cop with a handheld device will be able to recreate all of our lives on the basis of suspicion. So I do think that they have enormous capabilities. I think that those capabilities are different from the ones that they like to say that they have and need, because they're backward-looking rather than forward-looking.
If I can just add one thing to that, I think part of the imbalance there stems from the very fact that, like, I don't want to be insulting, but I think our law enforcement community is not as savvy about these technologies as people who are, on the other side kind of pushing back against them. And I have a feeling that if they weren't also really, really stubborn and listened, they might actually create tools that can perform these tasks in a more humane and democratic way. So, like, for a technical example, the very idea that there's, like, what's called off-the-record or OTR encryption, which is a protocol that was invented by some hackers that is awesome, that allows you to chat with someone in a way, or, like, to communicate, rather, with someone in a way that what you're saying, you can be sure that what you're saying is being said to the person that you intend, only during the time that you guys are having your conversation, and that's it. So, like, it's kind of like sealed and like encrypted in a way that, like, if you went back in time, you had no way of, like, reconstructing the stuff that transpired. But during the time when it matters, that's when and your data is live. That's when you have, like, authenticated secure communications. And so there are, like, I can envision, some sort of structure where we look at what police departments are receiving, and, in terms of, like, their inventory and their equipment that they hand up to these boneheads who just go out and, like, do whatever the fuck they want. But we actually propose technological solutions where those things can be, or, like, these tools or, like, whatever can be managed in a humane way, if they actually listened. And that's another battle that we have to fight.
Yeah, I mean, now I'm just thinking of, like, all my outstanding freedom of information requests to the NYPD. That'll
they're
be
the
worst.
They're really
worse.
They're really awful. Yeah. I mean, and maybe that's just to, like, that's a nice wrap up to look at kind of the trickle down effect that happens with these things. But when remembering that a lot of these capabilities are products, like, that are being built by third party contractors and sold to government agencies. And that those companies are looking for more clients, and, like, that's in a weird way, like, I think it's interesting how the conversation about police militarization has been more about, like, MRAPs and rifles than it has been about, like, cell phone tower interception and giving the NYPD the same, like, software that the CIA uses for their own, like, purposes. And I think that that's where a lot of the concern is.
So we can feel good for now that they're done.
No,
I mean,
because they're just using, like, okay,
yeah.
they have, like, somebody gave them the Kraken, and they unleashed that Kraken, and they have no clue what it does, what the implications are, how to properly use it, how to protect themselves and others when they're using it.
The Kraken tends to eat people, including the person who released it.
Because you have these incredibly powerful tools and people who don't necessarily know what they're doing with them and how to interpret the data.
And then if people say, like, well, you guys, like, actually, like, don't use it this way. Who wrote that algorithm? They're like, yeah, fuck you. We're not listening to you punks. That's about it.
So I wanted to just address the question about what are we talking about? Are we really just talking about, are we talking about information privacy? What the hell is that? Is it a coherent sort of concept? Well, I mean, legally speaking, I'm not going to address that, but I think from a conceptual level, the notion, what we have been talking about a whole bunch of different things. Of course, they are linked. I mean, actually, they're linked by the fact that, in my own head, between the fact that, as I said, we know a lot more about the world and it knows a lot more about us, and that's the time that we're living in right now. We're talking about the ways in which knowledge and power are disseminated. But you know, as far as information privacy, just a point about the concept, I think it's not the sort of concept we want to look for. I'm not saying suggesting that we were thinking this. A precise definition. I mean, most of the interesting concepts we deal with are not like that. They're concepts that are clusters of different threads. And I think the best that we can do, really, is just look for the marks that identify the sort of aspects or the threads of the concept that we're interested in. And that's we've been unraveling those threads here. And I think that's really the best that any of us can do on grappling with these sorts of issues.
I think we should probably call it a day. We can have some drinks and chat.
This is outrageous. It is obviously
are we still doing here?
So,
just wanted to thank everyone. It's been a great discussion, and I mean, I hope that it continues. I hope you read the issue, tell us what you think about it, and we're going to put this, we've been recording it, we're going to try and put it online, so it will be public, no hiding place, and you know, we just hope the conversation will continue and that you'll stay in touch with the points as well, and have a drink now and talk to us. Thank you.
If you haven't read the issue, it's really great.
It is really great.
And you should pick it up, read it, tell your friends. Some really smart stuff.
I'm glad that you cited it. I was like, come on.
Yes.